Yeah, before going into my talk, welcome to Chennai next year. The RSS Day will be conducted in Chennai, and I'll be the organizing secretary for this meeting. And thanks again to the committee to give me this responsibility. And then it'll be on October 6, 7, 8, and 9. It'll not rain during that time. Originally, it was planned in November. We preponed it because it is going to rain heavily after Diwali in Chennai. So you're welcome, and we'll be too happy to be there. It's going to be face-to-face meeting there. Now, I'm given a task of looking into the postprandial hyperglycemia and a thing that is called as postprandial lipemia. You all know that about postprandial hyperglycemia. How about postprandial lipemia? And together, what happens is a very, very important thing. And about how they can cause CV risk, which can be revisited. You all know that. Having just diabetes, you can say that way back in 1985, it has been said, after an 18-year follow-up in the Framingham study, you could see that men are more prone to get into coronary heart disease by 2.5 times, and women 5 times more common to get. And the Interheart study, which already Dr. Panikkar has also explained, you could see that in Southeast Asia, the myocardial infarction by having diabetes and after adjusting for age, sex and smoking, you can see that there is an immense increase in myocardial infarction among type 2 diabetic patients. Now, we're talking about these two phenomena, that is the postprandial hyperglycemia and postprandial dyslipidemia. This is otherwise called as combined, what is called as postprandial dysmetabolism. The postprandial dysmetabolism, is it very, very potent to cause cardiovascular disease, is an important thing. It looks like yes. If you see that how it can cause, look into that oxidative stress that can be caused by postprandial hyperglycemia per se and also by hyperlipidemia. And having a dyslipidemia in the postprandial, which is a different one, can cause arterial penetration by the lipoprotein particles, which I'll explain in the next few slides. And then in turn, all these factors would cause inflammation, hypercoagulation, and as well as endothelial dysfunction. They have got independent effect and combined effect both on this vasculature. First, let me go through the postprandial hyperglycemia. As the earlier speakers have said, that Dr. Panikkar has explained that this postprandial hyperglycemia has been there even before the onset of diabetes, the so-called ticking clock hypothesis. Now, there is very specific thing about Indians. If you give the same meal to a Caucasian and to an Indian diabetic, if you can see that the postprandial hyperglycemia with the same diet is more potent with Indian diabetics compared to Caucasian population. This is a very important thing what you can see that. Remember Dr. Anuj Maheshwar was also talking about postprandial hyperglycemia, a very important factor. Now, this is combined with what is called as our people are taking at least 15 to 20% more carbohydrate than the recommended levels. That is about 50% of the energy intake should be from carbohydrates, but we are taking in general, whether you are a diabetic or a non-diabetic, we take about 15-20% more. Now, so the postprandial hyperglycemia seems to be inbuilt in our custom, in our tradition. And apart from that, the effect on the same diet, the Indian gut is different compared to Caucasian gut, so that more hyperglycemic spikes can be expected in type 2 diabetic gut. Not that just alone. Look at the insulin resistance, the HOMA. The compared to Caucasian population, Chinese and Arabic population, you can see that in a set patient, we got more insulin resistance in Indian patients compared to any other population. It is just like Southeast Asia. Now we are also in part of Southeast Asia. Now this makes a very, very important factor. And we'll learn about that, how insulin resistance can be contributory to the postprandial lipemia, apart from causing contributory to postprandial hyperglycemia. So what we can do about this is that as far as the postprandial hyperglycemia is concerned, way back in late 90s itself, 1990s itself, San Antonio group has suggested that the postprandial hyperglycemia can be an independent risk factor for causation of cardiovascular disease in type 2 diabetics. And even DCC trial, even in type 1 diabetic, they said that we didn't look into the postprandial blood glucose. That also can be contributed to a great extent. Apart from that, either post-challenge, after glucose giving and challenge, or postprandial blood glucose, in all the studies, if we can see that, they have increased the cardiovascular morbidity and mortality, and including the carotid intima media thickness has been increased. So independently, postprandial hyperglycemia has been there from ages. And this is in about, you know, that DCOAT study, you can see that anywhere, this, look at the numbers where they studied this and followed it for more than 10, in some studies, they have gone for study, they followed it for 25 years and found this statement. Now, apart from that, you can see that the postprandial hyperglycemia in these studies have been found to increase the carotid intima media thickness, and also they can increase the arterial pulse wave velocity and also cause coronary stenosis. This again is because of postprandial hyperglycemia. And apart from that, it also can cause microangiopathy as well. You can see that postprandial hyperglycemia is responsible for even microangiopathy. Now, how does it cause? What is the underlying mechanism why it causes? Is it, we know that when we talk about postprandial hyperglycemia, it is not just that we have to stop at 2 seconds hour and after that becomes to normality. No, it doesn't happen. After a meal, it goes to the peak at the second hour, and it comes back to the baseline level only after 5 to 6 hours, not before that. So if you take 3 meals in a day, about 18 hours minimum, we are in a postprandial state, and only the last few hours after the midnight till next day morning before you take breakfast, you are truly in a fasting state. So we are exposed to postprandial hyperglycemia for almost 2/3 of the 24 hours we are exposed to postprandial hyperglycemia. Now, apart from that, because of the carbohydrate rich diet that we take and Indian gut is entirely different, not only postprandial hyperglycemia, the postprandial glucose excursions. This is a very, very important thing in causation of endothelial damage. Now, if you look into that, these things was postprandial hyperglycemia and postprandial spikes. You can see that they in turn cause oxidative stress, and this causes the thrombogenesis, that by increasing the platelet aggregation, increasing the pi levels and thrombin levels. And these thrombin levels are also can be increased even by postprandial lipemia. And also we can see that there is nitric oxide reduction, and so that endothelial dysfunction happens because of postprandial, that is oxidative stress secondary to that. And there is also inflammatory markers which are increased, such as NF-kappa B and cytokine secretion. This is another important thing. Even with hyperlipemia, you get increase in cytokine secretion. And hyperglycemia, not only does it also oxidizes the LDL, which is more determinant in causing atherosclerosis. So ultimately, various mechanisms, and we can see that there is a cardiovascular disease in diabetes. Now let us now look into the postprandial lipemia. The postprandial lipemia is basically characterized by an increased levels of lipids, especially triglycerides and triglyceride rich lipoproteins and chylomicron remnants after a meal. And then there are an increase in, there are so many evidences to state that the postprandial lipemia is a significant risk factor for cardiovascular disease because of its causative role in atherosclerosis and endothelial dysfunction. Now, we need to look into that. Postprandial hyperglycemia happens around 2 hours and it is short-lived. It may extend about 3 to 4 hours. But whereas after that, you can see that postprandial lipemia happens after 4 hours and it's extended up to almost 6 to 8 hours in a day. You can see that there is a postprandial lipemia as well. So we are having postprandial hyperglycemia initially, and then later on postprandial lipemia, and then combinedly they can cause endothelial damage to a great extent. Now here in this study, you can see that even we have a postprandial hyperglycemia throughout 24 hours, and you'll be surprised to see that irrespective of whatever the baseline triglyceride, even if it is normal in the fasting state, you can see in the postprandial state, the triglycerides are definitely are elevated compared to what we see in fasting state. So by strictly measuring only triglycerides may not be a great idea. According to the evidence that we have, we need to look into postprandial triglycerides as well, because all the 24 hours you can see that even after 3 hours of meal, you can see that there is an increased triglyceride and this is extended further. Now, this is an interesting, the suggestion has come out as way back as in 79 in this George Lyman Duff Memorial Lecture, where they have done some studies, both experimental and evidences in the human beings. What they found is that the evidence is presented that in humans and experimental animals, chylomicron remnants as well as low-density lipoproteins are taken up by the arterial cells. In persons who do not have familial hyperlipoproteinemia, atherogenesis may occur during the postprandial period. So it looks like that there is some evidence even at that time, way back in that. Now let us look into that, how this is happening, what is this postprandial lipemia. You look into that, this basically after taking a meal, it is the fat is digested and it is transported into the circulation as chylomicrons. Now once you get the chylomicrons into the circulation, they are hydrolyzed with lipoprotein lipase, and so that free fatty acids are released. Now this is an important factor, what we need to think about free fatty acids. We know that with insulin resistance, which is higher in type 2 diabetics, and the hallmark of insulin resistance is because of the high free fatty acids that we have. So we can see that once this triglyceride from the chylomicron is hydrolyzed and free fatty acids are released, and then they cause insulin resistance further, and then free fatty acids also have got a role in endothelial damage. Now, what happens to this triglyceride depleted chylomicrons? They become what is called as the chylomicron remnants, and they also sustain ApoB48 and ApoE. And they are very sensitive. The receptors for this Apo in the liver have been very sensitive and then take it to the liver for metabolization by the absorbed by the hepatocytes and then metabolized. Now look at the sequence of events. See, the if you are the remnants are removed in time by the liver, it's a different issue. But unfortunately, what happens is in type 2 diabetics, the removal of remnants is delayed in a postprandial state. This is the most important aspect. Now, when there is accumulation and retention of chylomicron remnants, what happens is that the monocytes are differentiated into macrophages, and then they take up these remnants and goes to the arterial wall, and more absorption taken up by the remnants by the macrophages, they cause foam, they create foam cells and start causing atherosclerosis. In a very simple fashion, I'm trying to tell you. Now, this is about chylomicron remnants. And then if you can see that straight away from the triglycerides which are happening, we have seen the triglycerides are elevated irrespective of what is a fasting triglyceride. And then they cause directly a oxidative stress and cause impaired endothelial function. And also they are an important role in advancement of already existing atherosclerotic lesions as well. So what happens is that both oxidative stress caused by triglycerides and macrophages stimulated by that is the taken up by the postprandial lipoproteins, they secrete cytokines and other oxidizing agents which harm the arterial wall and facilitate inflammatory process. And then if you can see that these cytokines which are released by these macrophages, apart from causing foam cells, you can see that stimulate growth of the smooth muscle cells and their migration into the subendothelial space and cause occlusion of the lumen and cause macrovascular disease in type 2 diabetics. So it's quite complex situation, but it's made simple. You can see that hyperglycemia in postprandial state and hyperlipemia in the postprandial state, both can be very causative factors can cause one. Now, the fourth reason why we can think about this is that the remnants of triglyceride-rich lipoproteins may also be associated with thrombophilic state by activating factor 7. And apart from that, remember there are release of FFAs, that is free fatty acids, those also responsible for activating factor 7 and in turn cause endothelial dysfunction, and atherosclerosis can be caused, and then attack can happen. And then let us look into that insulin resistance per se, how it can cause all these issues. Remember that insulin resistance is basically happening even before the diagnosis of diabetes. And then insulin resistance syndrome is part and parcel of lipoproteinemia, that is the dyslipidemia, and that be in even in the postprandial state. Now, whenever you have an insulin resistant state, initially we have hyperinsulinemia, and as the beta cells comes down, as the hyperglycemia proceeds, the insulin levels also will come down. And we know that we have a hallmark of the type 2 diabetes is that absence of first phase insulin release. These are the two factors we need to think. Now, the first phase insulin release will cause postprandial hyperglycemia. Insulin is a double-edged weapon. Let's say it's a double-edged sword, we would say that. Higher the insulin can be atherosclerotic. Lower the insulin, they can cause postprandial hyperglycemia and in turn cause endothelial damage. So it's a situation where we can have either hyperinsulinemia is dangerous and lower levels of insulin are also very dangerous. Now, in this particular study, what they have done is that they have done a standard fat-rich test meal in a hyperinsulinemic glycemic clamp. And what has been found is that there is a greater increase in triglycerides and cholesterol, especially the VLDL particles in diabetic subjects, compared to controls, which is more evident in the late postprandial phase. And these particles are richer in ApoB48, which will be supposed to be taken up by the hepatocytes, which is delayed in type 2 diabetes. Now here, you can see that it starts around after 3 hours after the triglyceride increase starts after 3 hours and is extended up to 6 hours. Like what we see in the postprandial hyperglycemia, postprandial lipemia, initially postprandial hyperglycemia, later on you can see that postprandial triglyceridemia or postprandial lipemia. So in almost 18 to 20 hours in a day, we are either exposed to short-term postprandial hyperglycemia and also later on by the postprandial lipemia. And this is a very busy slide indicating that these postprandial lipemia in various mechanisms, such as causes directly oxidative stress, increases inflammation, apoptosis, endoplasmic retinal stress, and it can change the mitochondrial dynamics and also cause endothelial dysfunction and cause arterial damage. And then we can see that there are several studies which have been there, association of postprandial lipemia with so many studies. You can see here in this particular several studies, if you can see that coronary stenosis, coronary lesion progression, severe stenosis and claudication, both in peripheral vascular disease. You can see that this is associated with increased triglycerides and chylomicron remnants, or triglycerides, chylomicron remnants, chylomicron remnants, and triglycerides. So the typical postprandial lipemia has been associated with this in these conditions. And one more association has been found that in the hypertriglyceridemia especially has also been responsible for causing total deaths as well as mortality and morbidity as well. So postprandial triglyceridemia is an additional risk factor for development of cardiovascular disease. Now, this has also been responsible for atherosclerosis in the way that in every study they found carotid intima medial thickness has been increased. Similar finding has been found even in Eric's study, where postprandial lipemia may be an important overall risk determinant and therapeutic target, which influences overall CVD risk factors such as HDLC. Now, let me conclude to say that postprandial hyperglycemia and dyslipidemia would synergistically act with chronic hyperglycemia as risk factors for the development of diabetic micro and macroangiopathy complications. But unfortunately, association has been found. But managing this postprandial hyperglycemia and postprandial lipemia, whether it can reduce the CV risk is not yet been evident. So probably we need more prospective studies addressing these issues. Association has been found. Probably we need to look into that. So we can see that there is a phenomena where is a postprandial hyperglycemia, which is a short-lived, about 2 to 3 hours or 4 hours, and after that we can see that postprandial lipemia is there, and together it can be more dangerous. 1 plus 1 is not 2, it is either 3 or 4. So there is evidence to state that, they support that, not just hyperglycemia control and HbA1c control, we need to look into postprandial lipemia and postprandial hyperglycemia, all the more relevant in Indian diabetic patients because we are a different phenotype. We got higher triglyceride as such and low HDL as such, and postprandial hyperglycemia has been there. So it is more relevant for Indian patients. Let us look into that as well. Thank you for patient here.